What most of you have been waiting for all day, right? The Blue Ecology and Attitude Switch, the finale, which we held to the very last. And just in terms of making a transition or bridging in to Michael's presentation, and Tim Pringle's going to do that, I'm just flashing an image I showed you this morning, so you've probably already forgotten about it. But I just wanted to pick up on this theme of, of being positive, there's hope, we are doing things, there's good stuff happening. In terms of the world of local government, again, that's my primary perspective in speaking up here today. And in order to help, ultimately, local governments get to what I, remember I said step three, you don't have to worry about what step three is, but to get there in terms of the watershed function, what Tim Pringle is leading is laying the groundwork for that. He's going to talk about the ecological accounting process. And in terms of a very, very quick introduction of Tim Pringle, Tim Pringle was the founding executive director of the Real Estate Foundation. I guess it was probably pushing 35 years ago now, right? Because you actually retired from them about a while ago. And so, and that's significant. Tim will explain why his foundation history is significant, because when he retired and was the inaugural winner of the BC Land Champion Award, at that same award ceremony is when it was announced that he was the inaugural president of the Partnership for Water Sustainability, and that was in 2010. So,
good afternoon, and I'm pleased to have a few minutes to talk about the ecological accounting process, which is one of the projects of the partnership under the Interregional Education Initiative. The ecological accounting process is made possible by funding from the Government of Canada, Province of BC, some help from the town of Comox, and also from the Cowichan Valley Regional District, and collaboration from a number of other organizations, and we need to recognize them and thank them for that help. The ecological accounting process has three goals: assessing the functioning condition of the hydrology of a watershed or subarea, or a creek shed in this case, because we're dealing with two creeks, confirm the definable benefits. Confirm the definable benefits of ecological services derived from the watershed, and describe what these ecological services may be worth to stakeholders. So we're dealing with two creek sheds, as I mentioned. One is Brooklyn Creek in the Comox Valley, and the other is Shuxwela or Busy Place Creek, which is in the Cowichan Valley Regional District. It lies just south of Duncan. The well-being of communities, as we know, depends on ecology, and the reverse is not true. That's the reality we have to deal with, and I think our practices on the landscape need to better reflect that reality. For more than 25 years, practitioners have been working with green infrastructure strategies, low-impact development ideas, and some advancements have been made, but we still have to ask the question, if we know how to do a better job of protecting our watersheds, why aren't we doing that? So getting the message across, finding the ways to really understand what we need to do is the key to that. When we started this project, we thought that if practitioners knew more about what the value of ecological assets were in financial terms, that would persuade behavior to change. As we've been working on this project, we think there's a more valuable question or important question to ask. And that question is, what is a watershed worth? So worth is the idea of worthwhile. Why would you spend time? Why would you spend energy? Why would you be engaged? When it comes to land, worth is value in use, what you do with the land, or what a buyer may think the land, what it's worth to do something on the landscape. Price or value is the transaction price, that's what it sells for. So I think it's more important for us to talk about value first, and later we may find the transition price related issues, we may sort those out later. So this is Brooklyn Creek, one 300 meter segment of the creek. This is in town of Comox. And this is before our restoration project took place. And this creek rises in the city of Courtney. It flows for a short distance through the regional district, Comox Valley Regional District. And then 2/3 of its path is through, it sort of bisects the town of Comox. Land development in the upland areas of the creek caused a lot of erosion and flooding problems. And in 2005, the town of Comox had to do some large-scale engineering to take care of erosion damages, put in a diversion floodway for very high levels of flow, and put in some watershed or some wetlands in an area that the town owned. Having done that, the town and the Brooklyn Creek stream keepers and two departments of the town realized that they need a long-term strategy to deal with Brooklyn Creek. So this is one of the areas that they worked on in 2014 to 2016. And this is a stream enhancement of the corridor. The stream used to run more to the right. They moved the course over to where it used to be its natural position. It had been deviated by past land uses. The town bought about 2 acres of land from School District 71, so the school's on the left in this photo. And they also put in addition to this enhancement, at the far end, going to the left, they put in a refuge area for fish. It's about 300 meters long and about 20 meters wide. It's a series of pools. So why did they go to this investment? What did it cost? So the total amount spent in the last 11 years since the agreement began in 2006 with the town and the stream keepers is about $560,000. There's a lot of leverage in this project for the town because the stream keepers have raised half of that money from various sources. So they work as a team on these projects. And I think some of the significant things are, one, they identify the stream as part of the municipal drainage system. So from the point of view of engineering, that's great because they're getting help to maintain an important part of their drainage system. Parks is the department within the town of Comox that handles the funding. Why is that? Well, because as a parks project, it attracts a lot of public attention. And people like to see the improvements that are made. They like to see that the parks department is creating new amenities along the trail system. And when salmon were reintroduced to the system a couple of years ago, people were thrilled to see the salmon. But probably the most important part of this outcome is that council members get approached on the street by members of the public who say, you're doing a great job, we love the parks, we love what you're doing. So the strategy of working this way has a cumulative impact, and the educational values, they may be informal, but they're very strong. So what are some of the values that have come out of, the project on Brooklyn Creek? The hydrology has been restored to be in a less altered condition. Municipal drainage has managed and improved. The threat of damage to private property has been reduced. Park amenities are increased. Salmon spawn again in the creek. Public interest in the ecological services, the watershed increases. Municipal council support remains strong. And the Brooklyn Creek stream keepers make consistent gains in their objectives to improve the stream. Now I'd like to move on to Shuxwela or Busy Place Creek, which is in the Cowichan Valley. In the Cowichan Valley. So in applying the ecological accounting process, the key step is assessment of the hydrology of the watershed, which is done through application of the water balance methodology. So we've assessed this watershed and come up with recommendations that we think would allow the community to address some of the risks it perceives in the watershed and harvest some of the benefits that it would like to get at a higher degree from the watershed. So we recommended three wetlands to be restored, one there, one here, and another one here. So the creek rises in Cowichan Tribe's land up here, flows through agricultural land, goes through some modest residential development down here, and goes down to the floodplain. And this floodplain area is the Coke Sila Industrial Park. And this area of the watershed is, again, Cowichan Tribe's land. And that's also in the floodplain. So these three wetlands could be restored. They did exist previously. They've been modified by mainly by agriculture. And if that were done, for about 12 acres of wetland restoration at $3 a square meter, it would be about $220,000 to do it. We got that number of $3 a square meter by looking at about 30 different wetland restoration projects done around BC. And this is sort of the typical price when you have machine work as a major part of the restoration, plus a lot of volunteer help in planting along the slopes of the wetland that's been installed. These kinds of wetlands have to be something that doesn't come under the definition of a dam. So they would not have control structures. They might have some kind of gate at the exit part of the water of the wetland, but mainly they're just a natural, restoring a natural place. What are some of the benefits that would be addressed by doing this? Oh, okay. Some of the benefits that would be addressed from the point of view of the stakeholders in the creek shed area. I looked at, I think it was more than two dozen specific references in official plans to preventing damage to the environment, maintaining sensitive ecological areas, climate change mitigation related bylaw strategies. Also, there's federal and provincial regulations that would be addressed by what we're suggesting. And the main values would be increasing the flow duration of the creek over the year by having more retention. It would moderate the high levels of flow in the winter, which cause erosion and have posed flooding threats to the lowland areas. It would prolong the summer flows, which is valuable for fish, flora and fauna habitat. So I think this comment summarizes very well how the Cowichan Tribes looks at Shuxwela. This was from one of the tribe members who said, "We realize the Shuxwela belongs in our lives." So I'd like to take a minute now and introduce Michael. So Michael Blackstock is a gentleman standing there looking elegant. He's an independent, I'll take my glasses off here. Michael's an independent scholar of Gitskan and Euro-Canadian descent. Michael holds the Gitskan name Ama Godim Get in the House of Giel Firewood Clan. His name means good-hearted man. He holds a Master of Arts degree in First Nations Studies. He's a professional forester, a professional chartered mediator, and a writer and trained Northwest carver. He's published over 25 journal articles, book chapters, books on the topic of blue ecology, reconciliation, and the Gitskan tree carvings. Most of these publications have gone through peer review processes by institutions such as UBC Press, UNESCO, Springer Press, McGill, Queen's University Press, Wilfrid Laurier University Press, and the International Association of Hydrologic Science. Michael has spent the last 17 years exploring in collaboration with elders the question, what is water? This journey has included 4 years as a member of UNESCO's Expert Advisory Group on Water and Cultural Diversity. He has founded his own research and conducted it independently of any organization. Michael's going to speak on blue ecology, a new attitude, and let's welcome Micah. Michael.
Thank you very much for you guys. Y'all doing good? Yeah? Okay. Simgigep, Sigimnak, Ganol, Guba, Wisk, Tuyoskin, Nisim, Koselis. Welcome, and I acknowledge everyone here today, and I'm a visitor on the Coast Salish territory. And it's our teaching as Gitxsan people that when we visit another territory that we ask permission. And I did that in a conversation last week with Morgan Garen from the Musqueam tribe, so I'm thankful that I'm being welcomed here. Lo'o umgo'odi, my heart is happy to be here. Wil ma anoch dim wocht, we dim vech silk, wil vech wilk ox. I'm here to talk about water. This is the Skeena River, just before the confluence of the Bulkley and the Skeena. And Gitxsan means people of the river of mist. We're riverine people, we're people of the water. And when I was preparing for my talk at UNESCO's expert panel, our first meeting in Paris, I went to visit my Auntie Belma, and I was sitting in her kitchen, and I was telling her about preparing and et cetera. And I said, well, one of the things I was wondering how I would explain, Auntie, is what's the difference between salmon people and water? And she looked at me and said, well, there is no difference. I'm going to talk about the question that I've been exploring for 17 years and still am exploring, is what is water? I'm going to be sharing the comparison and contrast between what I learned about Western science perspective on that question and what the indigenous perspective is. And in order to share that perspective, I have a team of experts. And they're experts in the indigenous knowledge. They're experts in water, rarely called upon, but I think at the end of my talk, I think one of my messages is that we would like to invite them more into the discussions around how we are moving into the future. So these elders were involved in the research, and they deserve as much credit as I do for this work, so I wanted to acknowledge them. What is water? One of the things that we struggled with in the expert panel, the UNESCO panel I was on, is what is water? We were asked to help rewrite the UN's water policy and give some direction, policy direction on that. And we spent our first day of 3 days of policy writing on the question, what is water? And we came up with the definition in the lower blue part, which is in contrast quite a bit from the one on the green at the top. Water is a chemical compound consisting of 2 hydrogen atoms and 1 oxygen. So we weren't quite comfortable with that when we were asked to come up with a policy based on a definition of water that could be used around the world with indigenous and non-indigenous cultures. We wanted one that was inclusive and came up with the one, water is the essential lifeblood of our planet with the power to generate, sustain, receive, and ultimately unify life. And instilled in that is the concept that water has a spirit, which is lacking from the one on top. I won't share this slide. Because the iceberg is kind of a symbol now of climate change. And I had the good fortune of meeting Annie when I was in tow with my sister Cindy. She was receiving an award at the National Aboriginal Award. And she introduced me to Annie. And Annie didn't speak English. Luckily, she had her 2 sons with her. And in the lobby of a hotel in Edmonton, I passed her my journal and asked her to write in syllabics the answer to my question, which was, what is water? And she wrote it very enthusiastically, and her sons were talking with her. I didn't understand her language, and it took me a year and a half to get the answer because I had to get the syllabics transliterated into what you see here. And she's talking about the icebergs and the teachings that were shared with her and that she shares with her sons around how to show respect for icebergs. What to do and what not to do, not to shoot them, not to defecate on them, not to camp on them, not to tease them. Because it is believed that there are people in it, and this is true. This is very similar teachings to the Gitzen. In my academic brain, I call it good luck epistemology. If you treat nature, water, icebergs, salmon people, the goats that are up above on Stigjoden above the Gitzen territory, if you treat them with respect, you will have good luck. Good luck will come to you. If you don't, you will not have good luck. So this, I want to share this because of the symbology around climate change. There's a flaw in Western science. Western science is great. Western science has brought us all the wonderful technologies that we enjoy today, how we got here, how we were served meals, how we're listening over this microphone, all the wonderful things we can do on our phones. Science is wonderful. But it has a flaw. The flaw is that in around the 16th, 17th century, when we were busily categorizing everything in the natural world, somehow water got categorized as abiotic, which means non-living. And that's influenced how we think about our environment ever since. And I'm suggesting we fix that flaw. Water is living, and I think indigenous people have a huge amount of value and knowledge about that living organism that's been studied for 10,000 years that can be brought in to a new form of thinking, which I call blue ecology. So two water worlds. I just want you to imagine a tandem bicycle for a second. But there's only one person on that tandem bicycle. And they're struggling trying to get that tandem bicycle to where they want to get it. But it's wobbling because there's supposed to be two people on that bicycle. That's what Western science is one person on a tandem bicycle with an empty seat, and it's wobbling. The missing piece is the water cycle at the top, the intuitive spiritual water cycle that can work in tandem with the physical, scientific water cycle. By the way, I just want to point something out with the around flaws with Western science, and I'm a person that dwells on the obvious and the foundation of concepts. There's no moon in the water cycle. If we're talking about the movement of water in our planet, why isn't the moon there? So forget about the indigenous missing piece, which is you. Right? Why isn't the moon there? So I'm just encouraging you to think about the foundational concept of water. So the comparison, Western science, water is abiotic, it's there as part of the physical world servicing the living world. And with indigenous knowledge, it's a mother, it's a brother, it's living. It's people in the iceberg. So blue ecology is about an ecological philosophy which emerged from interweaving indigenous and Western thought that acknowledges water's essential rhythmical life spirit and central functional role in generating, sustaining, receiving, and ultimately unifying life on Earth. So for the planners, the environmental planners in the audience, this is, to me, if that's the vision, here's a test. If there's a plan, if somebody's coming to plan a development in your city, I'm suggesting the first question you ask them is, how is it going to affect our water? That's the first question you should be asking. If they're building a coal-fired electric generation plant, well, they need water to cool it down. If they're building a nuclear plant, they need water to cool it down. If they're building a pulp mill, they need a lot of water to make pulp. So, well, if they're going to use our water, then what's their plan to treat it with respect? So path one, I'm going to share a bit of a story with you. Path one's the status quo. You guys have all heard about path one, the status quo, and where that's headed. Where's that path heading? I mean, there's lots of doom and gloom about climate change. I'm not a doom and gloom guy. I'm not going to dwell on it. But I experienced it this summer. My summer started, I was staying at the Sheraton Hotel here in Vancouver, and when you get off, you get on out of your room, you're going to the elevator, you're standing at the elevator, and there's a mirror by the elevator, and it's on it. The hotel luckily tells you before you get outside, before you've left your umbrella, that it's cloudy and rainy outside. Oh, that's kind of cool, I like that. Well, how did they do that? So I went down to the front desk, and they have a switch. The power of that switch. Oh my God. I looked at it, and I had the same reaction you did. It was kind of funny, and then I kind of went, my God, is that how we think? Do we think we have the power to make it rain or snow or be able to control the climate? When I hear about, you know, 2.5 degrees warming, we have to stay below 2.5. I just imagine this big dial, the climate change scientists kind of, you know, trying to move it to 2.5 and then everything's going to be okay. That's the scientific world that's based on the flaw. There's not a lot of humility in that. The signs of climate change were all around me this summer. First of all, in Kelowna, this is Kelowna, the sign of climate change. This is when I was coming back from a hike at the end of a long summer of smoke. I was in a Kamloops. And I was trying to escape it. And I went to Lake O'Hare and did some hiking and I didn't escape it. There was fires right from Kamloops right to Lake O'Hare, which is on the Rocky Mountains along the Alberta border. That's a sign of climate change. I worked for Emergency Management BC for a couple of weeks this summer as a negotiator. I negotiated evacuations with First Nations communities to help them evacuate and understand the evacuation procedures. So I was on the front lines of the wildfire stuff for a couple of weeks, and I had got some insights while I was there. First of all, on July 19th, a record was broken in Canada where the forests in British Columbia were at their highest susceptibility ever recorded for fire. So they have these, Canadian Forest Service has these indexes where they measure the susceptibility of a forest for fire and measures the dryness of the smallest twigs to the biggest logs. And when you see red, absolutely everything that was wood was highest susceptibility to burn on July 19th. That's when I was flying back from Prince George. That's the caribou on fire. What's the backstory to that? Well, later on I learned that we're breaking some drought records as well. So the kind of the common thing for me is water. When we hear about melting icebergs, hurricanes, rain, drought, if we put a water-first lens on that and try and understand climate change from a water perspective, maybe that's another path that we can take. Maybe we can throw some switches on our attitude towards water. Attitude is a collection of values, theories, philosophies, beliefs, principles that motivates and influences. So maybe we can change our attitude that water, from water being, having no spirit and not being alive, to water having it. How much would that cost us to switch our attitude? What I hear a lot from industry is, we can't do that, that's going to cost a fortune. Well, how much would it cost to change your attitude? Because if you change your attitude, you're going to be more creative. So how much would it cost just to change your attitude? That's the question I ask. And here's some example of people who have done it. New Zealand, India, declaring that their riverine systems, their rivers, have a spirit and have rights. They changed their attitude. Maybe we can change our attitude from Western science being completely right all the time to having some humility and looking at the system and may have some flaws, which I think it does, and that there are people that have been around you all this time that could solve that problem. And that's the indigenous people, because they've been here 10,000 years, they understand the water. So we interweave their perspective with Western science. And interweaving doesn't mean First Nations adopting Western science. It means that we're equal partners at the table, and our knowledge system has as much weight as Western science, and that Western science actually may have some flaws and we'll help fix them. Oliver Sacks, I've had some, I've spent time trying to think how I'm going to explain interweaving, and Oliver Sacks did a great job for me, so I'm just going to use his description. Interweaving at the microscopic level of two different materials in order to get something harder, tougher, and yet more elastic than either component alone. I was talking about building adobe buildings in Mexico, how the adobe structures were built. And they withstood earthquakes because of this elasticity of and the ability to interweave materials to make them stronger. And that natural systems have been doing that all the time. This is my definition. Collaborative process where apparently contradictory ways of knowing water, such as Western science and indigenous knowledge, are brought together as coexisting threads to produce a new cooperative theory called blue ecology. They're working in tandem. Another switch we can throw. I'm going to talk about leadership for a while as well. I think as leaders we have to show hope. We have to show our children we're hopeful. And we can't show them the fear. And we can explain the fear, but I don't think we should lead with fear. And blue ecology is all based on hope, on the hope that people care. So blue ecology is a new theory, philosophy, beliefs, and principles, which is an attitude. It's a new attitude, because that's what an attitude is. It's beliefs and philosophies and principles and values. It promotes the water-first approach, which is, if you're a developer and you're coming into our community, the first question you're going to get from us is, how is it going to affect the water? I believe this is a time for leadership. It's not a time for fear. It's a time for hope. And I read a book by David Hackett Fisher called Champlain's Dream, which basically is a long case study in leadership. And there's a concept in there that the author was sharing. It's called prévoyance. It's a French term for leadership. It's the ability to prepare for the unexpected in a world of uncertainty and danger. That kind of rings a bit true to me about where we are. While maintaining your principles, a mindset of learning to make sound judgments over the long run on the basis of imperfect knowledge. Well, there's some humility in there. Humans are terrible at predicting. And if we have humility to take that embrace that, then this leadership style, I think, rings true. So we need some principles to be able to base our decisions on in the future. The prescriptive era of science is over. We cannot prescribe through legislation, regulation, building codes, an exact future world that we can conform to that will ride up the storm. We have to have principles that guide us rather than prescriptions now. And these principles need to be durable enough. So in Blue Ecology, we've developed some guiding principles around the spirit, the harmony, the respect, the unity, the balance around the overarching principles. I'm not going to get into them in detail. I can share those later. But those are the guiding spirit principles. I mean, the first one, spirit. Water has a spirit. That's a guiding principle. So what are kind of some operational principles based on those guiding principles? And there's some up there, and again, I'm not going to share them all. Like on the bottom, you'll notice one here, the water cannot be owned. I mean, that's a foreign concept for Indigenous people, that someone can possibly own the water. Like, how can you own your grandmother? Who sold my grandmother? I struck a bargain. The elders struck a bargain with me. They said, Michael, we'll share this knowledge around water with you, but there's a bargain to be struck here. Is that when we give you this knowledge, we want you to do something about what we're worried about. We want you to do something about this. So hope is active leadership. It's not passive. Not I hope the weather gets better. I hope this or I hope that. It's about active leadership. So what are you going to do about it? Well, I have three suggestions. The elders always talk about education as the number one priority. They want good education for the children and the next generation. That's number one all the time. So that's an easy one. It's sharing this perspective of interweaving, collaboration, hope, the strength of multiple knowledge systems interweaving together to be stronger, that water has a spirit. This painting was done by Judy Wires when she was in grade 9. That was a few years ago. She's from Kamloops. And the challenge I put out there is, in education, everyone should know where their water comes from when they turn on the tap. And I was happy to hear that the three gentlemen down below me here are landscape architects and architects. I have been looking for you guys. Good. I was in Zaragoza, Spain. As part of the UNESCO, I was sent there by UNESCO because there was a water expo being held there in 2008. And they did an awesome job of developing the expo grounds in a way where you felt like you were walking through a water city. When it was hot there and you're walking through these kind of tarpaulins that misted you as you walked down the sidewalks, and there was water play parks and restaurants with water flowing off the tables and inside pavilions where the kids were playing in these kind of sprinkler systems and coming out soaking wet out of the buildings and sculptures, and it was just, you just felt alive there. The spirit was there. It did an amazing job. And out of that, I had an idea that why are the pipes, the water pipes in our buildings, behind the walls? If we want our kids to know where their water comes from, and if that's my grandmother behind the wall, why did we put her there? Bring her out. Put glass pipes on the inside so we know where the water is. We can see it flowing. We can feel its strength. Yeah, it needs to be brought out of the walls. I don't know how to do that, but I think you guys may. And if we took the education, we took the architecture, and we took the new attitude, and we put it all together, then we've got what I suggest, places like Metro Vancouver or Kelowna or Kamloops should strive to be as leaders in the world around water, on a water-first approach, water-first leaders, blue ecology cities. And that this is the kind of words that we use in those cities. Hope. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. So we have lots of time for you to interact with Michael, so what do some of you wonder in the back there?
Yeah, I'd just like to maybe add, as I'm looking at your presentation, I'm reflecting and I'm remembering. I can remember a time I had First Nations folks as neighbors, and I remember a school event where children were taken in the forest, and the event was called The Salmoner in the Trees. What I got from my First Nations neighbors is that the salmon is community. They would give us salmon, and we'd return the favor and help support them as well.
Yeah.
And it does occur to me that, you know, our language is a problem. Our language is a problem because it's very object-oriented. It doesn't recognize that things are connected, things are in flow. You know, for example, we say the word building, but we think it's an object as in terms of a process. And I think this is something we have to learn how to speak this way and recognize that the salmon is water, the salmon is community, water is the forest, human settlement is the salmon, or whatever food source that may be. And God is not a noun, she's a verb.
Thank you.
Louise Tal, identify yourself and what you do.
Louise Tal, I do wooden fish on chain link fences around schoolyards. We're called the Stream of Dreams. And I wanted to thank you so much for, you affirmed a lot of the feelings that I have around water, and especially around that everyone should know where their water comes from and know where it's going and know how to prevent pollution. And just really understand that they're not isolated, that water is a part of their life, and that it is our grandmother. I don't know if I really have anything more to say than that, except just thank you. I feel very grateful.
Thank you.
Grateful for meeting you and hearing what you have.
Thank you.
Over there, Michael.
Hi.
And your name is?
My name is Gustavo Manzano. I've been looking for authors that have this focus and trying to combine the knowledge of our ancestors and communities that have extended experience in spiritual versus science focus. I have found a couple that are very interesting. But one of the things that I came across, and I think that's a good thing about Western science, is the concept of ecological ecosystem services. These ecosystem services acknowledge that there is a relationship between man and nature, and that nature actually provides for free all these services, pollution, removal, purification of water, food production, all these kinds of different things. It is still embedded in with this anthropocentric way of thinking. But I think it's a good mix that acknowledge that nature does a lot of things for us. Mm-hmm. I wanted to ask if these ecological ecosystem services is something that you knowing First Nations communities is something that they could be open to explore as a, maybe as a central point that combines these values.
Yeah, good question, thank you. I like the idea, I'm of two minds on ecological services, to be honest. I'll share the first part, what I see of value in the ecological service concept, and that is that it broadens the scope and we're more aware of how nature and our communities interact and what value nature brings to us. The words I struggle with, ecological services, because in some ways I think with the teachings that I know, we're actually not the higher being here. The service idea seems to me to form a relationship of higher and lower, that the nature is serving us. So I don't like that. I see it as much more of a, we're lucky to get it. We're lucky to be the beneficiaries of water and the animals. We're just lucky. And if we'll lose that luck if we don't treat them with respect. They have the power to draw that from us. And I'm going to share with you a story that I was told by an elder. I'm going to get you thinking about the water cycle even more differently, right? I put up the spiritual one, the blue ecology water cycle, as a tandem. I'm going to kind of change it all up on you, because that's what happened to me. Imagine that Earth Mother is a sponge. So imagine that globe that Bob McDonald had as a sponge. But she's living. That's a living Earth Mother. And she has the ability to give you water or take away water from you by merely squeezing herself when the water comes out. You're breathing in, it's sucking the water back into her sponge. Now how's that for a water cycle? Well, there's a very important teaching there. We're lucky to have it. And our luck may run out.
Bonnie.
Hi, thank you so much, Michael. I'm Bonnie from Bowen Island. And I was really happy to see, I call it in Soda Rock, in your slides.
Yeah.
And I was first there about 22 years ago. And it was like fence post number 52, right? Like it was this really, a real adventure. And a dear friend of mine, who's a Kamloops Native, not a white Native person, but was brought me there. And was a very special place for her grandmother. It was, had come through certain generations. And it was, I felt very honored to be there. Mm-hmm. And she had spoken of the First Nations significance to that rock and the water and the living water that's within that rock.
Yeah.
And I went back just last year and had been there for 22 years. And the landscape around there had changed dramatically. And it made me sad. There was a lot of hunting going on. There was garbage. Yeah. And but I walked up to the rock and the water was still living. And the water was constant. And it was very rejuvenating. And so it gave me hope, that rock.
Yeah.
So it just is such a special place.
Yeah, it's an amazing place, isn't it? Yeah, it is.
Head over here.
So I'm going to relay a bit of a story. And Michael, based on your presentation, this is not interweaving First Nations with Western science, but it is an example about how First Nations and Western science can work together to enhance things. I mentioned it to you the other night at supper time. But I'm changing the interweaving piece because I heard what you said there. So we all know that First Nations are the people are very much attached to salmon and getting the salmon back in the watersheds and putting in salmon hatcheries and getting, you know, repopulating the salmon. And the Okanagan is no different. So I'm going to talk about a quick little story about in the Okanagan. I think, Bruce, you were at the same session that I was at when we heard this. I'm a part of the Okanagan Basin Water Board. They have a stewardship council. The stewardship council has about 30 people that go to there and just learn about all the different things that are going on in water and try to make water in the Okanagan better. First Nations are there, various scientists from various organizations and others. So at the last session, or maybe two sessions ago, we had a presentation from a scientist at the University of BC Okanagan. And this scientist had a bunch of grad students doing a lot of work on the genome of salmon. Now, I'm not an expert on this at all. I'm going to tell you the story. I might not get it all right, but basically they're looking at the DNA of salmon, which of course you know the DNA's got billions and billions and billions of things on it. And through a lot of work, they identified 8 markers that were different between the salmon that were river spawners and the salmon that were lake spawners. So I thought, well, that's kind of interesting. And so they started doing this in other work around BC. And I thought, so how does this really apply? And then the First Nations person sitting around the table, he goes, we're going to use that science, because if we're going to raise have a hatchery and have fish, and we want to target a certain watershed that we know we're short on, and we want to repopulate it, or we want to repopulate the lake, we would like to use this technology so that when we capture fish to capture the eggs, we can do a test on it to see where this fish is actually going to spawn. And then we can hatch those fish and we know we're repopulating that stock. I never really thought about it much until I started thinking more about the blue ecology thing, and I started thinking, now, here's an example of Western science. I mean, you can't get much more scientific than the whole genome and all that kind of stuff. And taking a lot of computer work and everything else to kind of isolate these 8 target little things that they can now sort of say, oh, that's a lake spawner, that's a river spawner. It's a really good example of how Western science could kind of help out where we're going with some of the efforts that the indigenous people are doing, and probably make them more effective in what they're doing. So I just wanted to kind of relate that to the group here.
Okay.
Do you have a question?
So first of all, thank you so much. I can't imagine what your family table is like. I didn't realize you were Cindy's brother. Okay, huge fan of Cindy's. Tell her if Michelle says hi. Part of the reason why I came over here was to hear this, because I'm downstream. So I'm actually Columbia Basin. We had salmon. We used to have salmon. We were salmon people. We no longer have salmon. But I just wanted to, for all of us, to a caution and perhaps an addition to add an S onto that Indigenous people, because Indigenous peoples have very different stories, and to have caution when we find, oh yeah, you know, definitely. At the same time though, there are different ways that our creation stories lay that out. And I just wanted to acknowledge that in our case as Tanakh people, there's no luck. It's a responsibility. And that was given to us when the water monster was killed and created human beings. And there's no luck. And it's about transformation and understanding that that transformation is part of our ongoing human beingness. And so I just wanted to add that in there, because I think you kind of talk about it, but not really. But that whole idea of transformation. And then the other one is around the use of elder. In our traditions, in our knowledge systems, we don't have age-based identities. It's about what you know and how you know and who you know from, and the validation from the people that are coming, that you can put it back 3 or 4 generations to who you learned that from and where they were connected to that piece. And so it's really important, because we're living in a time of the residential school impacts. And so many of our people aren't making it to old age and are learning and picking up pieces at younger and younger ages. So there's that whole cultural knowledge shift in our knowledge systems, and that Indigenous scholars actually exist. We're few and far between in the institutions, but we're there. And we're trying to bring this stuff back, right, to have these conversations. And so it's my hope that as you progress, everybody in this room, that you start to think about who's speaking, you know, who has that agency, and, you know, even the use of this quote-unquote tribalism that was talked about before is offensive, and it's privileged, and it's entitled, and that to create time, space, and place to hear is part of that hope, because I don't know how many Indigenous people or people that identify as Indigenous in this room, but I'm willing to bet it's a really small percent, like the percentage of how much fresh drinking water we can access.
Thank you.
Oh, Chris.
I'm Chris Quaith. I'm an immigrant from way back to North Vancouver. This is inspirational, thank you. It reminds me of an epiphany that I had in the building industry about 20 years ago when we were helping architects design a development. So I've had quite a bit of change involved on Vancouver Island. And the language was that we are creating a place, not just a bunch of buildings. And that seems to tie very well with water first. Mm-hmm. Because unless water is first, you don't have no place.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to make that comment.
Thank you.
Responses.
Yeah, that's a good point. Thank you.
Cathedral thinking.
Yeah.
Am I next?
You're next.
Okay. So hello, my name is Matthew Woodruff. As I mentioned earlier, I'm an architect based in Vancouver. And my practice occupies a relatively unique position because we do water and wastewater treatment facilities quite extensively. And I don't I'm not here to propose solutions at all, but I thought that I'm in a relatively unique position to offer some observations, and I just look to the room to respond to these. We're, for instance, currently doing 3 wastewater treatment plants and I think 4 reservoirs at the moment. And consistently we're approached to give a face, if you will, to the infrastructure. And I should note Jeff Cutler and Mike Keat on my side, who are landscape architects, who are working with us on many of these projects as well. But in listening to you and reflecting on the conversation, I've really drawn out 3 things that I simply want to share and put into space. The first is, as those tasked with telling the stories of water, what we find is we actually have no language even to describe water, and that's coming from a Western European perspective. And I think that's partly because we have no stories about water. The Great Flood is the last one that I can think of in a kind of Judeo-Christian or Christian tradition, but we have no source of water as a source of life, inspiration, a sense of commonality about water. The second is that we occupy very much a world which is focused on transactions rather than reciprocal relationships. Mm-hmm. And I think everyone in this room at some level is occupying that. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in order to keep my business going, I have to receive money from people, mm-hmm. I have to pay money to other people, mm-hmm. and when I stop receiving money, I stop working. So, but that's a fundamental obstacle, actually, to developing sustained conversations about things like water. We have the good fortune to consistently have these transactional relationships repeated with clients, Metro Vancouver being notable, though there are others. So you can start to sustain a thought, but if I were to share anything with decision makers in this room, that is critical if you actually want to have a meaningful narrative developed around your infrastructure, and again, really give expression to it beyond the notion that this is a motherhood good thing to do. Because the devil is in the details, not in the sort of engineering connections so much as it is in the way in which we can communicate a larger narrative that touches our hearts, because it doesn't happen overnight, because we're at such a disadvantage. And then the third is, and I think this is really important to acknowledge, and I think it's my culture, but we occupy a world of fragments. And while traditional cultures and indigenous cultures occupy a world of poles, and that is almost an irreconcilable divide in my experience, we're trying, and we know many people are trying. But for instance, water and wastewater are separated. Architecture and engineering are separated. Community planning and community members are separated from one another. So if I were to sort of wrap up these reflections, I think the first is we need to find a language, and that means finding stories, and that means taking the time and creating the space to tell those stories as communities. The second is that we have to get over the hump of transactions and seek reciprocal relationships where we can be invested in the success of communities and they can be invested in our success as humans. And then the third is seeking to establish wholes and work with wholes as much as possible. So I flip that out for response. But
I'm sure Robert Hicks might have a comment, but should we get a microphone to you, Robert?
Oh, I think when you talk about language, sure, I was just mulling about that because my mind was,
Thank you. Thinking about language, my mind was just sort of going off on a tangent discussion I had years ago with Kim, and that was when we were doing some work in stormwater, we were sort of hitting the wall, kind of like, this isn't quite working out right. Then we saw a book in German, and they used the term Regenwasser, which means rainwater, and then the light bulbs went on. It's not the storm we're worried about, it's the raindrops. So it's each individual raindrop. And the other thing that I was sort of contemplating is to get to the presentation, we're talking about water and hope. It's our encumbrance with language. I think anyways, and this is my view, that we have an advantage in using English. It helps us chain words together. Maybe not well, like wastewater, water that has no value, waste is null value. But it does allow us to chain things together, but it also prevents us from seeing things in a different context. So if you actually understand a different language, sometimes the problem solving makes more sense and is easier in the other language. And that's what I was wondering about. I don't know Gixen. I do have a lot of fun with iPhone apps, and one that I've been staring at is Halkominum, which is a related language to the Musqueam, I believe, speak Halkominum. And I was looking at their word for water, which is, I believe, mispronounced as ko, or something like that. But it's very specific. And then when we look at other things like dirty water, used water, fast-moving water, they're not even constructed from the same word. They're distinctly different words, very specific words, which allows problems to be seen in a different manner. And that's what I might turn to you and ask. Do you feel that language itself, by going outside of the English language, allows one to perhaps solve a problem or identify a problem or just view things completely differently and allow a different solution space to happen?
I'm gonna answer your question. I mean, address your observations. Thank you for your observations, your bigger observations. I was taught through storytelling. And storytelling is a powerful tool because it kind of removes you from the obligation of getting things right or wrong or writing a test. And they're easier to remember. And when I was doing research on tree carvings, it gets in to of a tradition that, as do many First Nations around the world, indigenous, including in the Cook's Island, Australia, all over eastern United States, Canada, the tradition of carving on living trees. So we're not talking about a totem pole, we're talking about, we're out in the forest and carving on living trees for a variety of reasons. And I was going to do my master's thesis on it, and I was trying to convince the university that these things actually existed because they were worried I was just going to be wasting my time and get my master's degree because I'm on a wild goose chase. So I had to convince them that it was a valid question to explore. And Some of the, I remember a teaching from a carrier elder, Nick Prince. He was a trapper and a knowledge keeper. It wasn't from Gitsan. I was talking to him about it and asking him questions about tree carvings, trying to get him to help me convince the university to let me do this. And he told me a story, which was a research methodology. And the story, I'm going to tell you the story in a kind of quick way. He was teaching me research methodology, and this is the story. He's a trapper, and him and his buddy were out trapping on the trap line for 2 or 3 days. So the trap line was like a 2 or 3 day route where they go out, set the traps, come back, rest, and then 2 or 3 days again, going out and checking the traps. In the middle of winter, this is in around kind of in Fort St. James area, if you know central British Columbia. Middle of winter, they were just on their last day of the 3 days of coming around the trap line, and they hit a really wild snowstorm. And they were exhausted, he said, and they came to a swamp. And on they were on one side of the swamp, and their warm cabin was on the other. Now, if you've ever had experience with ice and winter and traveling, is that they took a gamble that they could cross the swamp and the ice in the swamp to get to the cabin sooner. They knew that they were taking a risk. They decided they were going to take it anyways. They crossed the swamp, or tried to, and the buddy fell through the ice in the swamp. And now the shortcut they were taking turned into a 3 day long cut where his buddy almost died. And the message is, don't take shortcuts. So the power of story and language and story is huge, absolutely. And if you tell the story in Gitsan, or in his case in Dene, it's probably much more powerful. But we're faced with a reality where we have to communicate with each other. Like my auntie always tells me in Gitsan, the jokes are way funnier. I don't know Gitsan language very well. So she'll tell me in English, but she'll go, "Way, it's way funnier in Gitsan." So I believe that. It probably is way funnier in Gitsan. The power of language is huge, and it does form blocks. And we do need to understand each other's language. We need to have common language if we're going to develop a new vision and come up with new stories.
So Michael, I think that's a really good point to stop. Oh, is there one last person? Okay.
The corner.
The corner? Who was it? Rita. Okay. Oh, since you're a printer, let's go for it, right? The last comment, then we'll wrap up.
Thank you for that beautiful talk. I appreciated how it was both audacious and humble at the same time. I had a question about gifts, because I have that similar problem in terms of services. Like it's problematic in the sense of you don't charge your mother for her services or whatever, but it's important to make visible that function or that gift. And I appreciated the comment about responsibilities, because I hear these things as coexisting, and here we are on Musqueam territory, and thinking about how in Musqueam, and I don't speak the language, but I'm really interested in learning how the verbs change depending on where you're standing in relationship to the Fraser River and in relationship to the water. So you always know where you're situated in relationship to the water, and sort of reinforcing your water first approach. But I wondered if, in terms of alongside responsibility and relationship and reciprocity, how the notion of gifts function in our different cultures might be a way of thinking about our relationship to water. Just the thought about that.
Yeah, that's a very good comment, and it kind of reminds me of the giving back teachings that I've heard from elders, that we have this gift of, say, for example, you know, when I'm taught, when I go hunting, like, I give back. You've got to give back. You can't take. So nature is offering themselves to us as a gift, or it's a relationship, really. Like, it's the reason I have trouble with service is that it kind of has this hierarchy element to it, and it's an equality relationship between us all beings on earth. And if a being gives up their life to you, then you need to give back. And so that's the teaching around gifts that I see. It's a gift that we get, and we have to give back. We can't always be taking. So that's a responsibility for sure that we have, and we need to. Yeah. And it's an old teaching, nothing new. Yeah.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.